Well, how do you get to the Olympics from a boy that almost drowns at six? You know, I think it's one stroke at a time. You know, growing up in Bloemfontein, there were definitely other young swimmers, boys and girls, that were more talented than me. But I think, you know, you can't control the amount of talent that you get, how tall you are, how flexible you are, how big your feet and your hands are. But you can control your mental toughness. You can work on that. And your work ethic, that's something that you're always in control of. So that's really what I focused on, was to always outwork anybody. When you stand on the blocks, to know that you've done more work than anybody else. So after the 96 Olympics, I actually, you know, I stayed back in America. I flew to Tucson, Arizona. I'd never been there, but that was my new home. I arrived there, could hardly speak any English as a boy from Bloemfontein, real Afrikaner. And but it was a, yeah, I went to university there. And for me, the first couple of years was like I was in a movie. Began to hone my skills a little bit. I had a very big disappointment at the 2000 Olympics. Went to Sydney with being ranked top three in the world in three events, and the guys ahead of me were Australians. Now I head into the lion's den in Australia. Had high hopes of winning at least three medals, but the best I did was I got fifth place in the 1500. I was very disappointed. It was the same place I got in Atlanta. And I just felt like the last 4 years were really a waste. Although I did my best time in the final, broke a SN African record, and I quit. You know, I didn't, I said that's enough. You know, at the age of 22, I retired from swimming, and I gave up. I started working full time. By that time, I had gotten my degree, and so that was, you know, quite a big moment in my life. Then over time, yeah, I was working full time. I picked up probably 20-25 kilograms, but I was having a great time. But I mean, literally, I couldn't look at myself in the mirror in the mornings, because I knew that I was giving up on this dream. And you know, over time, I had this kind of debate with myself. You know, no, but you know, you gave it everything, and you're maybe just not good enough. And then the other rake on my left, you know, shoulder would say, "Come on, don't be a quitter. You know, don't be one of those guys that say what if, you know, for the rest of their lives." And I really didn't want to be a what if guy. You know, I wanted to know. Listen, I threw everything at it, and I, at the end of the day, even if I was not good enough, at least I knew I tried. So then, after 3 years of this debate between myself, I decided I was gonna quit my job. I'd saved up a little bit of money, and I was gonna try for my third Olympics and see what happens. By that time, I had worked a little bit on my explosiveness and my power, and I'd switched from, you know, from long distance swimming, you know, to sprinting, which really had never been done, you know, in the world. I qualified for the 2004 Olympics. By that time, me and Roland, we were, you know, we were very competitive. We had a very fierce rivalry that really pushed us, but something was happening at the 2003 World Championships. We made the final for the first time. A South African team made a final in the relay on the men's side. But we got last place. We were very disappointed, and we changed some things around. And then end of 2003, early 2004, things were beginning to change. We could feel like there was something special happening. We had Lyndon Ferns, who was a young guy. I think he was about 19 at the stage, but he was coming up, and we could see this relay team slowly, you know, developing. But we had failed so many times before, we didn't want to get our hopes up. And at our Olympic trials in 2004, we swam really, really fast. I think at that time we were ranked number one or two in the world. And that's when things got really exciting because Lyndon also, he was actually the first South African to go under 49 seconds, this young guy, and he said, oh, if he can do it, then we can do it. So now we had a team, and but we didn't have that belief, you know. We really struggled with that four guys from South Africa can actually go and win a medal at Olympic Games, because in the your depth in swimmers have to be so deep to get four guys to compete with the Americans. I mean, they've got almost a million swimmers. We've got 10,000 in South Africa. So. But we started to work, and we really became a team. And I think we were individuals before, but we made a conscious decision that we were going to work together as a team and really invest in each other. And that was one of the key words that we were talking about the whole time, is to invest in each other. So really care about that person. And I knew, and I think Roland also knew, that we still had to race each other in the individual races. But as a if you invest in a team, and we can achieve something much greater than as individuals. So things were getting interesting, and we're swimming fast all the way through the summer of 2004. We're doing great things in training. We're talking. We've got this great chemistry. We've got Lyndon Ferns, who's the very confident, bordering on arrogant maybe sometimes. I'm the more experienced. I'm the oldest. You've got Roland, who's at that time was the fastest guy in the world. So so the team was really shaping up nicely. We were still looking for our fourth swimmer. Flew to Athens, very confident, but with some politics and some turmoil behind us. And our coach, which they said that he was going to have accreditation and a hotel, when he got there was no hotel, there was no accreditation. So there's all these things that kind of mess with your mind, but we just kept on saying, listen, these are our goals, let's stick to it, let's not get distracted by all the nonsense. And then on the day of the relay, by that time we had become used to this kind of like a momentum. Every day we're getting faster, every day we're getting more confident. In the morning in the heats, our focus was only to make the finals, because you can break a world record in the morning and you can come fourth in the finals. So the purpose of the heats is to make finals, and we almost broke the world record. We were 3/10 of a second off the world record, which for us was a huge shock. We were tense and nervous and excited, and we almost broke the world record, and we were kind of blown away for a second, and all the media going crazy, oh, you guys are going to win tonight. And I told my teammates, I said, we're not doing any interviews, we haven't done anything yet, all we've done is just qualify for the final. Yes, we're in lane four, yes, we had a great time, but we've still got a long way to go. We were the only team in the final that swam the same four guys at night that swam in the morning. The Americans had four completely fresh guys come in. But when we saw their order, we couldn't believe it. Because if we had to choose an order, that's the worst order that they could choose for our strengths. And we were just kind of like, wow, this is just another sign that is about to happen. They put a guy, his name is Ian Crocker, first, which for us was mind-boggling. And luckily enough for us, Ian Crocker had the worst swim of his life, and Roland had one of the best swims in his life. And by the time Michael Phelps dove in as a second swimmer, they were a second or a second and a half behind. And I was standing behind the blocks because I was lost, and I was like a caged lion, my teammates swimming. And I had visualized this race in my mind. That was like one of my training methods was to visualize a lot, training the competition. And I had visualized this race more than 1,000 times. And I had always visualized the third swimmer coming in, Americans, us, Australia, and Russia. And when this race is happening, we were so far ahead, it didn't, I'd never seen it before, you know, I hadn't, you know, seen it in my head. And and then I realized I have to get on the blocks, it's my turn. And yeah, I mean, you train the Olympics once every 4 years, you train for five and a half hours a day, and then your race is 47 seconds. And now it's my time for 47 seconds to go do my thing. I've been waiting this for this moment really my whole life. So it can get very tense if you think about it like that. You've been preparing for this and you've got 47 seconds, and my 47 seconds was a good 47 seconds. You know, usually the last, you know, 15 meters, you get the pain just kind of hits, and it feels like you're swimming in like molasses or in honey, you know, everything moves very slow. But I had like a, I think I had a smile on my face because it was just, I couldn't believe that it's actually happening. And I'm quite a reserved person, and but when I touched the wall, I just, and I saw Lyndon flexing on the blocks, and we were screaming and yelling and completely out of character. And as a youngster, you always, yeah, you always imagine and visualize what you would do, you know, jump and punch the air or flip, yeah. And I forgot everything that I ever dreamt about, and I was just screaming and going crazy, jumping up and down in the pool. So a very special, yeah, moment. I certainly, at that point, I knew what it, how difficult it is to get to that point. I think Roland also knew. I think the other two guys, yeah, maybe not so much. It's also an interesting, you know, process that it really only sunk in 8 years later, when I was at the London Olympics. That's when it really, when I was not swimming anymore, and I watched it from the outside, and I said, "Wow, that's what we achieved." Really, overnight success. It was a 20-year overnight success. So that was certainly a big tipping point in my life. And then it was just after the World Championships in 2005, and I was actually on my way to a lunch that I had organized for my sponsors just to thank them. And I received an email, and opened the email, and I just kind of scanned, and it was an offer from the Qatar Swimming Federation to swim for them. And the amount of money that they had offered was it almost didn't register for somebody that lived off $1,000 a little bit more than a year before. To be offered, if it was in today's terms, it would be closer to 70 million rand over a 5 year period. So it completely threw me off. I was at the lunch, but I was not at the lunch. You know, I was thinking about this. I mean, these people have supported me, but now I have this offer. I really love being back in South Africa. I was a South African when I would race. The flag on my cap and on my swimsuit, it would give me that extra, you know, fire. I knew that as a South African, I had probably been through more and was tougher than anybody else. And now somebody asked me to swim for another country for that much money. So it completely threw me off. I obviously, you know, I discussed it with my dad. He was the only one that I discussed it with. I didn't want it to get out into the media, which eventually it did. But for me, that's really how I ended up at Val de Vie. It was because there were a couple of things that I thought, how much money is enough? I would lose that kind of passion, you know, for swimming, and that was the reason why I was doing so well. And it also challenged me, I think, to go and make something more than just be a swimmer one day. You know, I think I took the decision there that I was going to transition from being a swimmer and do something significant with it. You know, so I think it was a challenge to myself that, you know, when I declined, it was like, listen, the Olympic gold is not going to be, it's not going to be the highlight of your life. You're going to, you know, you're going to have to keep on working and keep on winning more Olympic gold medals outside of the pool. So I declined it, after about a week. I didn't take that long to, you know, to think about it. I declined it, and in my mind, that was pretty much it, you know, I'd moved on. But looking back, that was definitely a very big decision. And but I think it was also the right decision for me. If I had taken that money, I certainly wouldn't be here today where I am. I think it was, that would have been maybe an easy way out. Sometimes I like the hard way. That's more in my DNA, you know, is working hard and that persistence. And I'm so thankful, and I always thought that I'd make that money back, hopefully a couple of times. And so far here at, the things that we're doing here at Val de Vie, I think it puts me on track, you know, to achieve that. And I really love what I do. You know, I wake up every day and I excited about, you know, like what the day has to offer. Such a variety of things that I do here. I go home every night and I feel like where I used to feel in the pool, where I would go home and I felt, okay, I've improved. I'm a little bit faster, or I'm a little bit fitter. Now I go home and I go, I'm a little bit smarter, and I'm a bit more experienced, you know, than what I was, you know, when I woke up. And I think that for me is the really the most satisfying thing, and so I'm glad I made that decision.